Ladies and gentlemen, whether you like it or not, Hedwig!
Shut by little Bob, Darby, and we'll do sausage curls, chicken wings, it's all because of you. With your blow dry, feather back, Tony, home we do. Flip, bro, fridge, flop, it's all because of you. It's all because of you, it's all because of you.
Have you accepted me as your personal lord and savior? Well, you should have, because we are back with Hedwig, Inch by Angry Inch, the podcast where we analyze and tear down the walls surrounding the movie masterpiece that is Hedwig and the Angry Inch, chapter by chapter. I'm your usual host, you're sick of me by now. I'm John, hello. And I'm joined once again by a very, very special guest, the one, the only, Sheila Wolf.
Oh my God, thank you. That was a great introduction. I never expected that. Amazing.
Well, you know, only the best for you.
Of course. We could start to produce a show, my bae, darling. You can make my host for the next show. Oh. That's a good introduction.
Well, we'll discuss that and, you know, finances off mic.
Of course.
Hey, no, I'd do it for free. I don't care.
Really? I come back to you.
Yeah, you know, if you just supply a couple of drinks and some food, it's all good.
Yes, of course. It's always included champagne and food, so everything's fine.
The most important of all.
The most important of all is champagne, that's right, yeah.
Except, of course, for what we're here to talk about today, which is even more important. It's chapter 15 of Hedwig, titled Knowledge. We haven't got any songs for a little while, so I apologize in advance there's no songs in this particular scene, but sometimes these scenes are even more interesting than you expect, I find. Because everybody goes, oh, I want Wicked Little Town, I want this song, I want that song, but I find some of the best discussions happen in between. There's a lot going on here.
I mean, my experience with Hedwig was, I saw it first in the theater before I saw the film. So it was, and I don't have the scenes in front of me when I saw the first production on stage. Mm. And it was a really great experience to see the film after the production on stages. This was really nice because, I mean, I met John Mitchell Cameron. How was the name of the guy?
Oh, John Cameron Mitchell, yeah.
John Cameron Mitchell, thank you. I met him at the Teddy Awards years ago. And he was such a nice guy. He's small. He's not so high.
I've heard this actually. A couple of guests have said this.
Yeah. He's nice. He's a nice guy. But I mean, I'm wearing high heels, so I was much more bigger than him. And he was very kind, and I love to talk with him. But to be honest, I saw it first on stage, not as a film. Mm. And then I saw the film and I was touched. I was really touched.
No, I like that though, because I am the other way. Like, I've seen the movie first and foremost. So I like it when I have guests on who are the other way around. It gives a different perspective.
Most of the people are first seeing the film and then going to the theater because it's not so crowdy and not so popular. Mm. But I was invited by Nigel Francis. He was a nice guy from Frankfurt, from Germany.
Oh, yeah.
And he producing this. He bring his original born on the thing in London. And he brings this musical to Germany. And I'd never heard of it before. And it was I think, 2003 or so. I don't know.
Oh, really? Yeah.
Or not three, maybe eight. I don't know. I have to check my blog. In the past, I blogged about this whole my whole career, my whole experiences. And I just did it not for anybody else and just for me because I'm so bad in remembering things.
I'm the same. Don't worry.
So, and I will check it right now in my computer, but it was Nigel Francis. He was the name, and he brought it to Germany. And I go to Frankfurt extra for this musical, and it was really, really amazing because I saw that for the first time. I saw all the expression. I mean, he's not as such a small guy like Cameron Mitchell. He's more bigger and more, I don't know, he's more muscles. But it was really a good music, and it touched me by this whole story. And then I saw the film, I was more touched because the story is absolutely amazing.
Well, I think that's one of the best things about it in general is that basically anybody can and has played the leading role. You've had people from all different shapes and sizes and genders and everything, and it always works. It always fits the story. It's great.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. And it was 2008. I'm sorry. Well, not 2003. 2008 in Frankfurt. And I just bought tickets for the next Hedwig production here in Berlin. Mm. It's played by Sven Ratzke from Holland.
Oh, and yeah. I've seen him online. Yeah.
Yeah, he's such a genius because he's a cabaret superstar in Holland. Mm. And he's playing, he did this Hedwig production, I think, 5 years ago or 6 years ago in a small place in an underground theater. It's not the theater, but more a cellar. Mm. And it was such a great production. And we bring it back to a big theater right now. And this will be in times of Corona, it's very difficult to bring a big production back to Berlin.
Oh, I can
because
imagine.
nobody wants to play in front of 80 people.
Understandable. I get it.
Yeah. So yeah, let's go back to the scene. I mean, I'm just talking about my history. I'm sorry.
Hey, I'm going to ask you about it anyway. So that's the perfect way of getting it in there. Your history is very important to this. So yeah, we do get a glimpse of this Shroud of Hedwig, as I say, for a second. And I only want to bring it up again here before we properly move on with the scene, because Mike Potter, the hair and makeup artist, former guest of the show, he's selling these on his Instagram. Cheap plug there, everybody. Go and check him out. He keeps selling these.
Oh, that's about the commercial part. Wonderful.
Yeah, he hand makes them different. Every one of them's different, and he'll create them for you. I think he's finished his sort of second run of them, but he'll be back with more. Just keep an eye on his page. But then we cut to Tommy's room, and Hedwig is with him. They've got a kind of connection now. I get the impression that maybe beforehand, when Hedwig was sort of merely the young child's babysitter, you know, his brother or sister or whatever, that maybe they never really spoke. It was just like some woman he saw around the house and he didn't really interact with her. But now they've got a bond. He's been to see, well, they've had a sexual connection, and then he's gone to see them sing and whatnot. He's definitely got a thing for Hedwig, so to speak. It's very, he looks up to her. It's like she's the older woman.
Do you think she's the older woman for him? So
yeah, that's the impression I get, especially because there's a camera shot where you see Hedwig's leg. That's all you're seeing in the scene. And Tommy's looking up at her, kind of smiling, and he's so happy. It looks very kind of, it's almost dominating. It's quite sexy.
Oh, Hedwig is always sexy. Ooh. But I say, for me, the moment when Hedwig tried to kiss him was a little bit strange, because Tommy tried to cancel this moment because he was not sure about everything. And I mean, he's a young person, of course.
Yeah.
And if you are young, you are not you're not knowing everything about the relationship to maybe a transsexual person. I don't know.
Yeah.
You're shy. In my career, I met a lot of trans persons in the last 17 years, and it was always a pleasure to play with him or to play with the guys on stage and or with the girls on stage.
Yeah.
And I think for him, it was the first time, and he can't say, what should I do? That was the first moment. And I mean, in my career, it was when I started drag 17 years ago, it was for me also with my wife. She said, what are you doing? So I don't know. Just try it out. We'll see what happens. And she said, do you want to be gay or do you want to be trans? I said, I don't know, but I don't think so, because I don't like penises. but at the moment, it's interesting for me. And let me try it. And then the person on stage became more reality. And that was a way. You are not sure about everything. It's a flow. I mean, and Tommy was at the moment, he was a little confused about the femininity of Hedwig.
Yes.
And that's a strange moment for him, maybe.
Especially because of his background, you know, his family's very religious. They're a military
family. Yeah.
He's probably been told these people are evil. Like, don't go near them. And he's like, but they're not.
Today we have a lot of people. We are always thinking like that, that we are some crazy creatures, and we are not allowed to live in this world because we are, perverts, or I don't know.
Yeah, yeah.
So I met a lot of people. Always, I mean, the newest influence going from TikTok, and I use it very often, twice a day, with to spread in the information about trans and drag all over the world to the younger guys. And there are so many questions about drag and about trans persons, yeah, from the heterosexual normal cis white girls and guys. And it's crazy, and it's good to teach them on the one way, but on the other hand, you see how there's a lot of misinformation about the parents, and crazy.
Yeah, no, it is good though to be spreading the message and teaching and whatnot, because people do get a bit confused. Like, they assume as well, if you do this, it's like, oh, so you're a gay man. And it's like, no, not necessarily. Yeah. There's many other factors at play.
That's a pretty. I mean, we have more than 60 gender identities. I mean, that's there's a lot of space for everyone.
Exactly. And maybe this is Tommy finally discovering this, like, a lot earlier than a lot of people as well, because, well, you know, back when this movie was made, these topics were still not spoken about a lot.
That's true. In
public,
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Especially people who don't conform to one thing or the other. Like, because Hedwig kind of, especially by the end of the film, they see themselves almost as a completely separate thing. Like, I am now a complete person. I'm Hedwig. I'm not a man. I'm not a woman. I am me. And that would just confuse people back then.
Absolutely. And that's such an amazing message, because I mean, she had this bad experience with the operation, and of course she's something in between, and that's good, and that's a good thing. I mean you don't have to be this one or the other.
Yeah,
you can be everything in between, and that's the reason why I love the possibility to have 60 gender identities. I mean, I did a TikTok years ago, not years ago, maybe half a year ago, about gender identities, and a lot of comments came in, and they say, we only have two genders. Yes, that's true. Maybe three, but we have 60 identities, more than 60 identities, and they don't understand that. They don't fucking understand that, because they can't imagine that people can be more than man or woman.
They're stuck in that trap, aren't they?
Yeah, they're stuck in the trap, exactly.
once you free your mind of that, I find your life becomes richer. You're a much better person. There's no more faking of anything. It's great. It's freeing.
Yeah, it's freeing. It's free yourself. It's exactly. I had a conversation today with a trans man, and he said it's for him. It's a very step to recognize that himself could be much more better. And that moment when he decided to be a man was much more bigger than now, because now the way is much more harder, and that's a very rocky way to become a man from a woman, because you have a lot of operations, you have a lot of hurtings, you have a lot of people to have to trust to, and but that's absolutely fine, because it's not the most hard thing is to make the decision to be someone, to be something new.
Yeah.
Because all the people around you say, you are a woman, you have to be a woman, you are a woman. And then something you said, no, I can't be. I would like to be a man. And that's my way. And to decide that, and that in your mind, in your head, I mean, think that it's a very, very hard decision.
Oh, definitely, definitely. And Tommy is wrestling with his attraction here a little bit, isn't he? But is Hedwig, like, she gives him a weird little look at the beginning here. I find, is she kind of suspicious of him, of all men? Like, she looks intrigued that he's interested, but also kind of on guard. Like, she's not sure, should I go for this? Is it right? Is it wrong? Will he screw me over?
Yeah, I mean, she's a girl. She's the person who give him all the identity. She give him the name. He give him the look. I think she's the founder of Tommy.
Well, I know there are some people who think that Tommy is Hedwig. This is weird, I find. They think he is kind of a manifestation of, like, what Hedwig wanted to be. And it's kind of, they're the same person. Whereas I see it more like it's philosophical, you know, they're not literally the same person, but they kind of, Tommy represents a part of Hedwig, so that's why they create the superstar Tommy Gnosis in him. That's maybe what they wanted in their life prior.
Yeah, but to be true, to be honest, as I said, the first time I saw Hedwig on stage was in the theater, and this was the same interpretation to me, because I think that's always built in her mind, and the person Tommy Gnosis is just in her mind, and she wants to be the superstar, the male superstar, and because she lost everything, she lost this whole male being. Can you say male being? Is that a good word?
I don't know. That makes sense. Yeah,
that makes sense. Okay, and so I think that was an interpretation of her to be this superstar as a man, and because she lost this male stuff. But in the movie, it was a little bit different. I wasn't sure about it at the end.
Well, okay, I like that actually, because I come from a world of movies I like are often quite strange. Like, I'm a big David Lynch fan. So,
oh, me too, by the way. Oh, me great. Too.
Oh, thank God we're going to get along even better. Because David Lynch, like, things in people's minds become real in the movie. Like, they become physical reality. So you could say, well, maybe Tommy is Hedwig, and it's just portraying it as real. You're seeing it physically.
Yeah, you're seeing her, of course. You're seeing him, and he's playing his role and everything. But as I said, for me in the theater, it was always clear that Hedwig is Tommy in another way. But just in her mind, I don't know, it was a surreal interpretation. But yes, I mean, David Lynch is always a good example for something like this, because his films are so crazy and wonderful.
Yes.
I mean, his last film, Inland Empire, I saw it 4 times. Ooh. And I don't understand.
It's one of those things. It's more about the feeling necessarily.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I saw Mulholland Drive maybe 20 times. And I'm going to Los Angeles in 2018 and go to the Mulholland Drive just to make a picture, a selfie with the sign.
I'd have to do it. Yeah.
That was really good.
Oh, that's one of my favorite films, Mulholland Drive. Definitely.
Mulholland Drive is so good. I mean, the actors and everything was it blazed me away. It was so good. Mm-hmm. And but Inland Empire was like, I mean, I go to the cinema because I'm a big David Lynch fan, and I sit in the cinema, and it was maybe 10 persons inside. And it was really crazy. It was a big cinema with 10 persons.
That's a good sign to me.
That's a good sign, yeah. And I saw it. I saw the film, and it was over, and I said, okay, I have to see it again. And then at the second time, I see, okay, I have to see it again. And so it came. And I don't find the whole... I can't interpret it for the first time. No, that was crazy.
It's the weirdest one. And that's when I then go, right, I'm going to go online and I'm going to read loads of articles trying to explain it. And everybody has a completely different interpretation.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, me too.
And I love that, though. That's great.
That's a truth. I mean, as I saw Lost Highway, I was so, so entertained, because it was, I have my idea what you want to say with this film. And then I saw Mulholland Drive, and it was the same. I had my idea what you want to say. And then I saw Inland Empire. I saw,
totally
okay,
different.
Okay, what is this? What can I see in this? I can't see something. So that was really great. I mean, all the films from David Lynch are really amazing. And that was a kind of a good compared to Hedwig, because for me, at the stage was the stage production was a little bit like an interpretation of can I be a man? Can I be a famous man? Can I be a superstar? And then on the film, I saw, okay, she is the teacher of Tommy Gnosis, and she's not a different person. This is two persons.
But through creating the character of Tommy Gnosis, in a way, it's like creating maybe the persona they would have wanted to be, isn't it? Like, this could have been me.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I think that's part of the jealousy aspect, isn't it? Like, because they create Tommy, he becomes huge and famous, and everybody loves him. It's like, that could have been me.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. Yeah, yeah. I mean, we all have these dreams. I mean, we all with the drag, we trying to create personas who are a kind of okay. We stay in the public. We are well known because a lot of productions. We're going to a lot of productions. We saw a lot of people, and at the end, you go home, you de-make up yourself, and then you are not this person anymore.
Yeah.
And to be both is very, very different, very difficult. Because for me, for the first time, I do it for. Do you know the Morten Harkett from A-ha? He is the lead singer from this first ever boy band A-ha.
Yes, I like A-ha.
Yes, of course. Yeah. And this guy was the person who wants me to have him in this music video, and but he wants to see both characters, the male character before, and then Sheila Wolf after the transformation. And that was the first time I ever show my male person before, because I want to protect myself from the a public a little bit, but this guy said, okay, no, we have to, I want to see both, I want to see the transformation. And because I was a big fan from Morten Harkett and A-ha, and when I was a child, I said, okay, I do it.
anything for you.
And that was a start. And at the end, I saw a lot of transformations, and I show everything about both the characters. So yeah. And but I can understand that. I mean, I did a video for a singer-songwriter girl, and about 10 years ago, and we showed both sides of me. And the story was as Wolfgang, that's my real name, as Wolf, I go to the theater, go to the bar, and have to wait as everyone has the drink, and then I'm on the line, then I'm get my drink after everyone has served. And as Sheila Wolf, I just go to the bar and just say, what do you want to drink?
Straight away.
Yeah. And that's exactly the difference between your imagine, your character, your building, because you're such a glamorous person, stand in the audience. Everyone is looking at you. Everybody want to see you. I mean, sometimes on a good way, sometimes on a bad way, but they see you. As Wolf, nobody sees you. That's the difference. And that's the same with Hedwig and Tommy, because I think Hedwig was also a very impressive person, but not as impressive as a very attractive, from everyone is loving him. He's a successful musician, have a lot of groupies who want to go in bed with him. And I think that was the kind was Hedwig want to be.
Yeah, yeah. That's what they wanted, and it's sadly not happened for them. It kind of does by the end of the film, but then they sort of reject it. But, you know, I'll get there eventually.
Spoiler.
Finally, we will get there. Tommy here, he very much like a geek, he starts rocking out and being cool. And Hedwig has a cool line saying, the bands that Tommy introduced her to were new. Boston, Kansas, America, Europe, Asia. Now, that's funny because they then say travel exhausts me because they're going all around the world there. But those are all rock bands. That's a great joke. They're all the names of big bands. They've deliberately picked ones that have the names of places.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. I love the scene where they stay in this moment where they go in this, I don't know, was a diner. I don't know where they're playing. And a groupie is coming and try to go to Tommy. And she's like, now go away. And then he crashed this bottle and he tried to cut her and go away. It's my creation. This was crazy. Nice.
Yeah, it's bottle time. I'm going to smash some people's faces.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
How dare the fans come up to Tommy? He's mine. I love as well here where they're talking to Tommy and explaining their history. Yeah, because Hedwig leans in to kiss him and he sort of recoils, as we mentioned.
Yep.
And she answers his quite difficult question about their past. There's a lot to tell. And it kind of makes me laugh how they just described the Second World War as, oh, there was a big war.
Yeah, exactly.
A big war. You might have heard of it.
I mean, the funny thing on this situation was when I was a child, there was this fucking war. And I was on the west side. And I had a kindergarten, and the kindergarten was right close to the wall.
Oh.
And we always go twice a week or once a week, I don't know, to this. There was some steps, and you could when you climb the steps, you could look over the wall to the other side.
Oh, I've seen that in pictures. Yeah.
Yeah, and the teacher is saying, "And this is the east side of Berlin." And as a small child, I mean, with 8 or 7 years, you don't recognize what happens with you because there's a wall, but border, and you can't go over it, and that's it.
I suppose you don't question it, do you? You're like, oh,
yeah,
okay.
There's no question, but what it's behind the wall, no matter what, I mean, that's the east side, nice. And then in the same moment when you stand on this, on these stairs and this on the wall, there came the American patrol with all these MGs and all these machine guns and jeeps and everything. That was a very crazy moment in the past. And then, that was the kind of moment when I saw the movie, when I said, oh, that's my childhood. That's nice.
That's cool to hear, actually, because I have always wondered how people sort of from Germany, especially around that time, would react to it. Like, would you identify with it and things like that? So that's great.
Yeah, it brought a lot of memories back, a lot of memories, because West Berlin was such an island in East Germany. And we are always was very special. I mean, I understand that this moment when Hedwig decided to fell in love with this American guy because he offers the world.
Yeah.
Because we were on this small island, and we always called the rest of Germany. Said, okay, in Germany we said "die da drüben," so it's just the other side of the world, because we are just in, we are catched, or I don't know, we are. How can I say, we are trapped in this big country around us, East Berlin, East Germany, and we are this fucking small West Berlin, and protected by the Allies. And it was a crazy situation. I mean, 30 years ago, it's a long time, but I'm an old person. I don't know.
Hey, I can imagine. I mean, I've been to Berlin, but it wasn't until after the wall came down, and you can still kind of imagine it. I think even from just going around and looking at museums and things, it's strange.
Yeah, there's an Allies museum that's very nice. It's in Zehlendorf, and it's very nice to see.
Yeah,
there's a big Hastings, a big plane, and. Yeah, I mean, but that's the funny thing is that I can imagine this wish from Hedwig to see the whole world, to leave this small, I mean, trapped thing, and say, I do everything for you because I love you. I make this operation for you, and yes, let's see the world. Let's become famous all over the world, and that's. I mean, these times in the past was very crazy. I mean, it was Germany, or West Berlin was a very free city. I mean, we had David Bowie here and everything.
Yeah,
it was very, very subcultural. That was very nice. But at the end, it was a bordered city.
Yeah, it's a strange combination of things, that, isn't it?
They
kind of don't go together. It's like very hip and cool and liberal and open, but then it's also right on the forefront of all that.
Exactly, yeah. And every time you want to go over the border, you have to pay 25 D-mark, not yours. It was D-mark. That's the old currency.
Yeah. Oh God, yeah. Oh. I keep meaning to buy. I collect things. I'm a collector. I'm sad. I'm pathetic. And I keep meaning to buy old money from that kind of era. When I went there, people were selling it, but I'm like, is that real, or are you just doing it for tourists?
No, that's absolutely real.
You never know.
Yeah.
Because I then again, I did do the silly, cheesy tourist thing. Like, Checkpoint Charlie. It's like, well, we can stamp your passport with the old stamps. I'm like, yeah, okay, do it.
Oh, really? You can?
Yeah. Okay. They'll stamp them with the stamps, and you have to pay a little bit, and you get a picture with the guards. But you have to pay more for that. It's like, I'm not really bothered. I just want the stamps.
Crazy. Okay. So never heard of it before that you can get some stamps on Checkpoint Charlie. But yeah,
they're all the old. I've got them here. They're the old stamps. I've got there's the Soviet one. There's all the different ones they give you. There's the French section. There's the UK one. The USA. There's all kinds of different stamps.
That's
so
funny.
It looks like I've been to these places, but I haven't really.
Yeah, so as a Berliner, you are so far away from all these tourist points. That's crazy. I mean, I did a TikTok for Miss Maisel. That's a funny thing on Amazon Prime, a funny 50s, 60s show.
Oh yeah,
that's very nice because I love this girl who tried to break out of the world of dominated men. It was so crazy. as a comedy person, I did a tribute to her, and then I go to this Elias Museum for the first time, and it was very crazy to go in as Sheila Wolf in a 50s dress to come to these guys from the Elias Museum who never saw a drag queen before.
That's wonderful, though. Introduced them to a new world.
Yeah, it was nice. You can all that find on TikTok, by the way. Yes.
Oh, I'm checking it out.
Check it by Sheila Wolf, and then you can see it.
Well, you know, as listeners to the show will know, because Laganja Estranja kind of convinced me to get a TikTok, I now have one, but I don't use it very much. So there you go. That's going to be one of my next follows will be you on TikTok. And I like here how Tommy, you know, asking about Hedwig's past and stuff, Hedwig starts explaining, but because we, the audience, know the story, we can't hear it. It's a really cool way, I think, to show that she's telling the tale and also to represent like the double meaning. It's a bombshell to Tommy's sheltered world, as we say. It's gonna blow up his mind almost. And we hear an actual bomb. That's great.
That's true. You reflect all the details. That's amazing.
That's why I decided to do this. I'm like, I have seen this movie too many times.
Yeah, I think so. That's true. Oh, to be honest, then... I just saw the video as a movie met twice or three times. I don't know. I mean, I see this. So you sent me this scene, and I saw a lot of times this scene. But yeah, the movie I just saw it twice, I think. But I see the theater part maybe four, five, six times. I don't know.
That's amazing, though. That's great to me. I like all these perspectives because the theater show, like as you kind of alluded to before, you're kind of imagining these scenes. You don't see them. Because Hedwig's talking about them, but you don't see them happening.
Yeah, that's true.
Mm. Well, and then the bomb explodes. And I guess this is where Hedwig gets to their gender reassignment. And Tommy looks kind of shocked, not disgusted or anything like that, which is impressive for someone so indoctrinated in religious stuff and whatnot. You know, he's not disgusted. He's just a bit shocked. Like, oh, whoa, I wasn't expecting that. And then he comes out with his line that a lot of people seem to like. Have you accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior? Which confuses me a little bit, but okay.
Oh, me too. Because that was the strangest moment on the scene. Because I said, what? What are you? Why? Why Jesus? I mean, okay.
I know. Yeah. Like, is he saying that maybe despite sinning, as in, you know, being queer and whatever, it's okay, Jesus will forgive you? Is that what he's... I don't know. I don't know too much about these things. But, you know, it's not the right attitude necessarily, but at least he's not being aggressive or anything. He's genuinely curious, isn't he?
Yeah, I mean, to be honest, I'm never so addicted to Jesus and all this stuff. So, I don't reflect the scene so much with this moment. But yeah, I don't know why she's saying this. I don't know.
It's a strange one. But Hedwig has a good comeback. No, but I love his work.
That's true.
And in fact, actually, I just thought as a child, you saw in the flashbacks, they were watching a cartoon called Jesus Was Good. So they have a bit of a connection with religion and things like that. Like they at least have a grounding and an understanding of of religious things and Christian things.
Yeah, maybe. I don't know.
And Tommy argues that what Jesus was saving us from was his father, God. Which kind of makes sense. He's not wrong. Because, you know, Jesus takes on the sins of mankind. So if he doesn't, God would punish man just for being man. So that makes sense. He's not wrong. He's actually right. He knows what he's talking about.
I mean, maybe the interpretation of people is always different. I mean, maybe Cameron Mitchell would want to say that that Jesus or the church always tried to bring you on one gender and not on something in between, and that was the moment where they can I don't know, put it in this movie. I don't know.
Yeah, maybe. And then they talk about a bit that's a bit like the origin of love, because he says, what kind of God creates Adam in his image and then pulls Eve out of him to keep him company? And that did remind me of the origin of love, you know, the people being split and torn apart. So maybe that's why Hedwig feels the connection with Tommy. Because it's not even necessarily about Christianity. It's just about the origins of man, of love, of people, philosophy. So that they're connecting with him on that level. Like, we're on the same kind of wavelength. We both understand this kind of stuff.
Yeah, I'm not sure about that in this moment that Tommy realized that there was a girl in front of him. I don't know. Maybe just the mother, or I don't know.
Maybe.
Yeah. For me, the moment was like he accepted her as a mother, as a producer, more or less, but not as he... Hedwig wanna be the in a relationship with Tommy, but I think Tommy don't want, because he's too young to reflect everything about relationship.
And you find out later on, spoiler everyone, that they kind of aren't too intimate. So maybe that's what it is. Yeah, maybe Tommy's like, well, you know, I respect you and I love you in a different way, but I'm too immature to explain this. So I'm kind of just going to play along and, you know, get what I can from you. Like, maybe not in a nasty way, but he just doesn't know how to say I'm not interested, you know.
But the funny thing, if you stay with the idea that Tommy and Hedwig are the same person, then that is a struggle between both. And I mean, I know the struggle for myself when I go out on drag, and the people ask me, yeah, and what's your wife saying about this? And they say, okay, that doesn't matter, because now I'm Sheila Wolf, and now I'm the person on stage, and now I'm the producer of the big show. Yeah. And what kind of situations are coming that you're thinking my wife is had a problem with it at the moment, because she's proud of me at the moment? And and then people want to know, and are you struggling with yourself because you don't know what you are, man or a woman? You said, I'm not struggling. This, yeah. I'm not struggling. I'm not 100% what I am now, by the way. And I don't want to be a girl, but I can play a girl. I can play a girl as perfect as I can, so that you are going maybe in love with me, if you like, because I have tits, I have ass, I have everything. I don't change my voice, but you, if you love a girl with a dark voice, it's me. Yeah. And that's a funny thing that in between, as people always thinking that I'm struggling, that people are doing drag are struggling because they can't decide man or woman, but we don't struggle. We know everything 100%. If you're doing drag, we know what we do. That's the point.
It helps you know, if anything.
Yeah, of course. Yeah, it helps me a lot. I mean, it helps protect myself. I as Sheila Wolf, I can protect myself from assholes or from everything, because Sheila Wolf is like a child, a shield.
Yeah.
And it's a kind of superhero magic person who protect me from angry persons or from, I don't know, attacks, verbal attacks or anything.
That's a bit like Hedwig. Once they put their wig on and they become the rock star Hedwig, it's like a superhero.
That's a point. Yeah, that's exactly the same. When I put my lashes on, for me, that the transformation begins with me with the lashes, not with the wig, with the lashes. Because when my eyes are changing from the normal male eyes, there's a lot. It's a long process because I glue everything, and I put these lashes on and a lot of makeup, and then I look in the mirror and the eyes are looking different, completely different. Nobody will recognize these eyes from before to later. And for me, the transformation beginning with these lashes. And it's like the same with the Hedwig's wigs. Yeah.
Yeah. I've never thought about that. Once you put the lash, the eyes, as they say, are the window to the soul.
Exactly.
So if you transform the eyes, oh, that's cool. I like that. I'm stealing it.
Yes, you can steal it.
Oh, and then Tommy asks for the apple. Metaphorically, not so much the knowledge, he's been given that just now, but he wants Hedwig's experience, teaching, wisdom, the love, not necessarily sexual love, but you know, as you brought up actually, the looking at Hedwig almost as a mentor.
Yeah, absolutely. For me, I think in the movie, Tommy saw Hedwig as a mentor, not more.
I like that as well. Everyone's different angles on this. Wonderful.
But at the end, for the as I said, for the stage production, for me it's totally clear that Hedwig and Tommy are the same person, but not in the movie. And so, what can we do with this fact that that for the stage production, I think there's just a struggle between both characters in one person, and. When I say Sven Ratzke in the last production of Hedwig, he impersonates this moment so perfectly from becoming Hedwig to Tommy. It was a perfect moment in this moment. But it's spoiler because if you go to the theater, don't expect that because it's not there.
Oh.
Now it's a very nice moment because for me it's always this moment when you transform yourself from man to woman with all these shades of layers of what you need to transform. I mean, there's a lot of hard copies you need to put on. You need to put some hips. You have to wear a corset. You have to wear boobs and everything. And under all these layers are the same person, but you look totally different. And that was the reason why I love Hedwig so much, because it was exactly a part of my life, because Hedwig was written long before I started drag, but it was when I saw it first before and never heard of it before, but then I saw this stage production and I heard there's a movie. Oh my God, I have to see that. And then I saw this movie and I cried because it was such a lot of in parts of my history and of my career.
Yeah, yeah. Very, very personal to you. That's great.
Very, very personal, yeah. I mean, there are always steps in your career, in your career to become a drag persona. And it starts with the first time when you put some I don't know, some eyeliner on and just a lipstick, that's all, and maybe a rude wig. And and then now, 17 years later, you have a process from 3 hours to become a different person with a lot of layers, with a lot of hips, with a lot of makeup, with a lot of shadings, contouring, and blah, blah, blah. And at the end, you stand in front of the mirror and said, okay, that's a different person, but inside you're the same.
And that's what's cool. That's what I love about it so much. Yeah, and you get that in Hedwig, although it's more about not necessarily drag, but you know, gender identity and things like this. It's the same kind of world. Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I would try to give everyone the recommendation to see Hedwig when you are not sure about trans. Are you being a what I am, but I mean today I think that the younger audience are more off, more open to be everyone, to be in between, to live androgyn, to live whatever they want. But 15 years ago or 40 years ago, it was kind of I don't know, self-murdering
yeah definitely
when you try to be something different. I mean, there was a lot of travesty in Germany. Not a lot, but there was a few travesty in Germany, and they was accepted because they are very famous. And then in the 90s, in the 90s and 2000 years, there was no travesty at all in whole Germany. It died. I don't know why. It was no travesty at all. And I mean, RuPaul brought a lot of new influences to the kids, and that was really good. Yeah.
That's the thing. Like, people have a lot to say about RuPaul in a bad way lately, but, you know, he's definitely helped with the public perception of these kind of things.
Absolutely. I mean, he's opened doors. I mean, and now he's a kind of conservative in this moment when he decided to always bring gay men to RuPaul's Drag Race, because I think he should open for every gender identity his show. But that was a little bit crazy about Ru. But the rest was, he opened a door, and this door is now open, and we can step through, and we can do whatever we want now. I mean,
hell yeah.
I mean, the point is that we get also in Germany. I mean, we need not more longer than America, but now in Germany we are having this Queen of Drags TV series.
Oh, I tried to watch that. I found it online. I know it's technically illegal because it's not on the TV here. But the second episode, they muted all the music because it was breaking some copyright thing. So I couldn't watch after episode one.
Okay. I mean, to be honest, it was not my favorite drag format. But it opened also doors. I mean, it was the point is that this format is not. I was asked to play in it, and they asked me, "Yeah, we want to have a straight influence in this show." I said, "Oh, that's a good idea. Let's do that. And what is the fee?" And they say, "Oh, we don't have a fee." I say, "Oh, what? Not the truth. I don't do 6 weeks in Los Angeles in front of a TV camera, not with any fee. That's not possible." Oh, yes, that's a casting show. We do it like this. And I say, "Okay, then not with me. I'm sorry for that." And so I do. I did in March this year. I did my own TV show. It's called The Diva and Me. And it's on TV now. It's like Netflix in Germany. So
okay. Yeah. I'll see if there's any way I can watch this.
Yeah, of course you can. You have to stream it, but you have to take an abo with TV now, I think. And then you can, but it's not very expensive. I think it's €4 or so. I don't know.
Oh, that's fine. I can do that. Yeah, hell yeah. Check it out, everybody.
Yeah, check it out.
Although most of our listeners are American, I don't know if they can. But so Hedwig hugs Tommy, holds him close. After that, you know, Hedwig's going to turn this kid around. She snaps the Peter Frampton record from his hands. You're not listening to that anymore. It's time to educate him about David Bowie, Lou Reed, Iggy Pop. Some of my favorites of all time. And pretty much everyone who's come on the show has picked one of them at some point as a musical choice. Because not only are they so relevant to the character and whatnot, but everyone in this world just loves these guys, right?
Of course. I mean, I mean, I'm from Berlin, and David Bowie has very creative years here. And I go to the David Bowie Museum at the where was it? Was it in London or where was it? I don't know.
Oh yeah, there was one in London for a while.
Where
they had all his costumes and things.
At the V&A or V&A, I think. And it was really fucking amazing. It was one of the most amazing exhibitions I ever saw before, and there were all the costumes and all his life and everything, and it touched me. And there was a big room, it's like a cubic, and you saw him in 20 meters playing his songs, projected by millions of projectors, and you can lay on the ground and saw him playing. It was really a great moment.
Oh, I'm so jealous. I didn't get to go. My partner went. I didn't get to go.
Yeah, oh my God, really?
Yeah, I was working. I couldn't. So they went down to London to see it, you know, with other people.
It was one of the best experiences I ever had with exhibitions. I'm not a fan of exhibitions, by the way. I was in Den Haag last 2 weeks before, and then we go to the museum with a lot of very imprisoned pictures, but to be honest, it was nice. But I'm not a friend of going to a museum or going to exhibition and saw something. But the David Bowie stuff was really great. It was entertaining. It was, nice. And David Bowie was a very big influence for me too in my youth. So, of course.
Hell yeah. I mean, I don't have all of the... I've got on vinyl record, I'd say 90% of his music. I haven't got all of it yet. I'm working on it. But I haven't got a lot of 90s stuff.
Did you saw him live sometimes?
No. You know what's so annoying? When he brought out... Well, Black Star came out, you know, his final album. I had it pre-ordered for like a year. It came out. I got it on like, I think the Friday. I listened to it and was like, this is amazing. He's definitely going to tour this album. We'll buy tickets as soon as they go on sale. And then, of course, by like the Sunday, maybe the Monday, he was dead. So heartbreaking. And also my whole plan of we're going to buy tickets was completely ruined.
Okay. I saw him in front of the Reichstag in Berlin with a spider web tour. And it was really fucking amazing. It was, I was really stoned, but.
That's the best way to see the spider.
That's the best way to see, yeah. But it was a big festival in front of the Reichstag. A year or 2 years before the wall came down, and that was Eurythmics was there, and David Bowie was there, and Genesis was there, and it was a fucking three days festival, and it was so good, and it was done 3 days in a row. And the good thing was that to see David Bowie once in a lifetime live on stage, he was as big as my thumbnail, because I was very far away. But to lay down on the ground to see the stars and to hear him live, it was really great.
Oh, and what a setting by the Reichstag. Oh, it's great.
Yeah, it was crazy. And so he influenced me a lot. And so that was all my choice for the music.
Oh, well, we'll get to that in a bit. All I saw in front of the Reichstag was a stray fox at 3 a.m.
Oh, a stray fox. Nice.
I know, I wanted to follow it. My partner's like, don't follow a fox.
Never follow a fox. Always follow the white rabbit.
Well, it was 3 a.m. I was very drunk. I was like, let's just follow this fox, see where it goes.
Try to find the white rabbit. That's more impressive.
I'm trying to remember I think we were coming back. We'd been out in Kreuzberg. Where'd we been? There was a bar called Wild at Heart.
Yes, of course. I know that. Yeah. I performed there a lot.
Oh, well, we'd seen a burlesque show and stuff there. And there was a drag queen there as well, who was great. But this was years ago now. And we were really drunk coming home and just went for a little walk at 3 a.m. It was lovely.
You saw a drag queen at Wild at Heart, but in a burlesque show?
There was a drag queen, yeah. What were they called? This was about 6 years ago, though. I think they were called, like, Bobby Blowjob.
Bobby.
Oh, you've seen him.
I know Bobby very well because he was part of my. I am the guys who are doing this show in this small Wild at Heart called Teaserettes. And I was kind. It was part of the Teaserettes years ago. And Bobby Blowjob was part of the Crimson Carnival gang. He was two guys who throwing knives and something nice. on and cutting himself with. I don't know the name in English when you have to put two letters together with a kind of metal. And he put it in his body a lot of times, and that's a kind of this guy. And Bobby Blowjob was a really nice person. I mean, he had some problems, mental problems in the last 5 years.
We all do, don't we?
We all do, yes, of course. But Bobby was kind of part of my team. That's very funny.
Oh, that's amazing. Everything's connected.
Yeah, everything's connected.
Oh, it was a great show. It was a great show anyway. Are they still performing?
I don't think so. No. This the troupe is splitting because the head is going to Munich. And I started my show 6 years ago and leaving this group 6 years ago. So it was, Yeah. But we have a wonderful time together in Berlin and all over the Germany because we are touring with five girls, me, Bobby Blowjob as a Crimson Carnival gang, and
two guest stars. I don't know, Lola. I don't know the name. So
well, it's been a while. You can forget. I'm not a forgetful person.
I'm so bad with name. Lola Promilla. Now I have the name. Lola Promilla was the name. That's very nice. Promilla means like this. Do you know what Promilla is? No, you don't. Not in English. No.
I've heard the word before. My German's pretty bad.
It's a scale. If you have to test someone on alcohol, it's a scale as promille. And she's calling her Promilla. It's like because she's always drunk.
That's great.
Yes.
And I identify with that.
Yeah. Me too.
Oh, and after Hedwig gets Tommy to sing in the oven, you know, use what you know, girl. That's what Hedwig did. She comes up with the stage name for him.
Yeah.
And I like all of these options. Like Tommy Syzygy. That might be a bit too difficult for some people to say and understand.
Yeah, exactly.
And then Tommy Vile. That's really like super punk. I like that. Tommy Taint. That sounds like a drag king. All of these are cool. Obviously, they settle on Tommy Gnosis, which is awesome. Gnosis, of course, being Greek for knowledge.
But do you know how she came on Greek? I mean, what is it? Why Greek? I mean,
I think it's just because Hedwig has clearly got they have a history with philosophy. They like the classics. In The Origin of Love, of course, they sing about Greek stories and things like this. You've got Zeus in there. So I think just because Tommy brought up the idea of knowledge and Adam and Eve, so Hedwig spun it their way, like. Well, what's the philosophy I know? I know this kind of stuff. So I literally just think, well, like, well, I'll use that, and this sounds cool as well.
That's true. Yeah, Tommy Gnosis is nice.
It's nice. It's got a good ring to it. I don't know if the drag king name of Tommy Taint would have the same kind of vibe. Actually, there's an American I know in Berlin who is a drag king. And they're called HP Loveshaft, which I thought was
great. Heard of him, yeah.
Oh, you know him? Oh, he's really cool. I've only met him like twice, I think. They come over to Liverpool sometimes and perform here. But yeah, they're really cool. And they would probably, I could imagine them performing with someone with this name, Tommy Taint.
Tommy Taint.
It's great. And the guitar Hedwig gives him, that's amazing, isn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. I mean, I'm not a very well-known guitar expert, but it looks amazing, yeah.
It does. And I mean, obviously, in real life, this didn't happen. But in the movie, I get the idea that Hedwig has maybe decorated this themselves. Like, they've painted it. They've sparkled it and whatnot. Obviously, John Cameron Mitchell will have got someone to do it. But that's the idea. Like, I've made this for you. Because we've seen they're a very artistic person.
Of course she is. Yeah, she's a creative person, and I mean, I can imagine that maybe she had done this guitar, and yeah, I can follow you.
And it's their kind of art that we've seen, like the characters on it. It looks like the artwork that's supposed to be theirs earlier.
Did you saw the whole artwork on the guitar? Did you see any detail in this moment?
Oh, I've zoomed in.
Of course you zoomed in.
Zoomed and enhanced.
Of course you zoomed in.
It's great. And I love the idea of, well, Hedwig's like, well, okay, you're a very religious person, so I'm going to incorporate the fish. Because I like this symbol for Christianity, the fish. I think that's quite a nice logo.
Yeah, that's true. I mean, fish is always good because I'm a fish from the Sternzeichen. What is astrology?
Oh, yeah, yeah. And they say here how they were making money solely doing music. They were very happy. Let's see if it lasts. It probably isn't going to last, is it? You know, they think, oh, this is nice. We're going to have a great time together. We're making music. We're making money from it. It's going to be great. Sadly, we know that doesn't happen.
No, at the end, they have to split because to reflect it to myself, I wait at that moment where my stage persona is killing my other character, and then I have to decide to kill my stage character to be alive, Yeah, but yeah, it's sometimes. I mean, when I started drag 17 years ago, I said with the age of 50, I will stop this because then I'm an old guy in a glitter dress that nobody wants to see that. But to be honest, I'm not 50 now, and everybody wants to see me, so I can't stop. So,
Stop! Don't ever stop.
never stop. Now, I mean, to be honest, sometimes you have to stop because there's this moment where you can't look in the mirror and say, no, that's not me anymore. And it comes nearer and nearer. So that's the truth.
Oh, well, now I'm bald now, which doesn't help. Yeah, because I like to dress up and be kind of gender neutral and whatnot. And it is a bit more difficult when you're bald.
Yeah.
When you lost your hair.
No, the hair's not the problem. You can wear a lot of wigs. You can lay out a lot of wigs.
Oh, I do. But if I don't wear a wig, people are like, oh, that's really cool, the way you're wearing makeup and a dress, but you're bald. And I just pretend like, oh, yeah, it was a decision. It was a deliberate choice.
But for me, to be honest, it's for me the most important thing, I think, is the skin. If your skin is too old, you can't cover it with makeup. You can't cover your age with makeup anymore. And then, you can go to a doctor, but I'm afraid of doctors. So,
me too.
So I have to stop sometimes because my skin's getting older and older every month.
Oh, same for us all. Don't worry. Don't you worry. You still look great.
Thank you.
Oh, but speaking of old, because this is the end of the scene, technically, I have a section I call, in my terrible German, Ostalgie. Where I like to talk about something from East Germany that relates to the scene. So I, having no knowledge of music, decided to look into guitars available in East Germany. I like to go really overboard, and everybody, you get loads of listeners liking this bit, and I have no idea what I'm talking about. But, you know, a lot of them are now just sort of interesting for historical value or odd design features. A lot of them aren't particularly great guitars, but it's agreed that behind the Iron Curtain, East Germany had the best guitars.
So really?
That's something to be proud of, yeah. East Germany and Czech. The Czech guitars are also very good, but everyone else's were crap, apparently.
Okay, I never heard theirs before.
Yeah. And there's a lot of manufacturers going on in both East Germany and Czechoslovakia. But most of them stemmed from actually historically making violins. So they're violin manufacturers who were asked, like, can you make some guitars as well? They're like, okay, we'll give it a go.
Really?
Yeah, and apparently they did quite well at it. They were all right. They were okay, which is, you know, better than probably the Soviet ones. Like, they're fine. You can play them.
Okay.
And they would kind of, an interesting fact I found was that unlike Western ones, they wouldn't like stick to a wood. They would just use any wood that was kind of available at the time. Like, we've got lots of this wood, make it out of it. So you get the same model of guitar made out of different wood from whatever local thing was big at the time.
And that was made in the East Germany?
Yeah.
Wow.
And Fender stole their idea. Like, oh, okay, we'll just make different wood as well.
Oh, wow, I learned something new. Never heard this before. Cool.
There you go. And I've got a list of some of the brands, but they mean nothing to me, so I won't go into all of them. There's Pearl Gold, Meinl und Herold, Musima, Migma, I don't know, Taco, which is, I'm going to say this really badly, that's short for Tauscher and Co.
Ah, okay.
Hernsdorf, these are all big brands. And apparently, most of them don't make them anymore, but collectors sometimes do buy them out of sort of curiosity, a nostalgia kind of thing. So go and check them out. I did also find a list of places you can buy them, but that'll bore everybody.
Yeah, I mean, not everyone is addicted to guitars, so yeah.
Yeah, so me either. I tried playing them 100 times, and I get bored every time. I can't do it. I wanted to be the next David Bowie, and I can't do it.
Did you know what the guys from this movie are doing right now?
Like, here you got Michael Pitt, you know, playing Tommy Knossos. He's appeared in quite a lot of things.
Oh, okay, nice.
He was in Hannibal most recently. The Hannibal Lecter TV show with Mads Mikkelsen.
Oh, there was a TV show on Hannibal Lecter? Oh my, my God, never heard this.
Oh, it's amazing as well. It's my favorite interpretation of the character.
Oh, wow.
It's great. And Mads Mikkelsen is a great actor. I love him so much. And it's really dark and twisted. And a lot of Americans complain because they can't understand him because he's from Denmark. And I think it's great. I'm like, Americans, now you know what we all feel.
Yeah. Okay.
Because I think most European people are perfectly fine with the Danish accent. Like, okay, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, but if you go to Wikipedia, you can't see anything about John McCameron Mitchell about his career after 2006.
Yeah, he does kind of small things. He did direct a movie which I've reviewed on the Patreon, everybody, if you want to go and check that out, which is called How to Talk to Girls at Parties. Yeah, right. Which is, it's a punk rock movie. It's based on a short story written by Neil Gaiman.
Ah, okay.
The writer. And that I really enjoyed that movie. But lately, he's just kind of doing Hedwig stuff. He's toured Hedwig again. He's brought Hedwig back as an older woman with a grey wig, which I thought was quite funny.
Really? Yeah, nice.
Yeah, yeah. And he did a lot of shows in Korea, in South Korea, as that character. And I knew there were plans to bring it to the UK that some of our former guests have told us about, but it's obviously, because of everything happening, it's not going forward at the moment.
Okay, yeah. Sadly. I mean, that's strange because the time for trans or I don't know, drag performers are going well at the moment, and a lot of RuPaul girls are going superstars around the world. And I mean, Hedwig should be a new, I don't know, reanimation.
At the very least, get him on to judge for Drag Race. Come on.
Yeah, that's the point. Yeah.
Why not? Or actually, what's more fitting is I really like the show Dragula.
Yeah, with the Bully Brothers. Yeah.
Yeah. Could get him on there.
They are crazy.
Abora from Dragula has been on the show. Yeah. And, you know, there you go.
They are crazy. It's true. Nice, darling.
Now we'll do music recommendations before we wrap up. So I get two because I'm a narcissistic arsehole. So my first music recommendation, because it ties into the sort of religious aspect and things, I went with Depeche Mode's Personal Jesus.
Oh my God, really?
I thought that was a great choice for this one.
That was my childhood.
Oh yeah, you like the same music as me, I think.
Yeah, because I'm growing up with this Depeche Mode stuff. I have all the discs here, the original hard copies, the big ones.
Oh, I'm jealous. I'm so jealous.
Yeah.
I love them so much. I love Depeche Mode, New Order, all these kind of groups.
Oh, my God. Nice. Yes.
So what's your musical choice? What have you gone with? It can be any style.
I mean, any style. To be honest, it's I'm a very big rockabilly fan, and Johnny Cash was one of my favorite. And I missed him to see him live half a year before he died in Germany, he wanted to perform in Germany, and then he died in the USA. And I go to a friend of mine, asked me, "Will you come with me to Johnny Cash?" And I said, "No, he could come next year, but that's possible." And then he died, and that was really,
that's like me with Bowie.
yeah, it was really crazy. And Johnny Cash was one of my favorites, even the older years was my really big fan of him, and of course David Bowie, because that was my childhood, just to be his Major Tom and to be Space Oddity, and it was. Also the years after that was very nice, because I saw all these movies, and I'm a big fan of Bowie.
Mm. Same here. So do you have specific songs you want people to listen to, or should I just pick any from either that I like?
Major Tom by the Space Oddity is very nice, or
Hey, I'll go with that. It's a great choice.
Yeah, take this, because let us go to the stars, because we can't stay on Earth anymore.
Yeah, we fucked up this world.
We have to go. I'm sorry.
Oh, my other choice for people that's going on the playlist is a band called The Sonics, who I like, but I'm not hugely familiar with, but they have a song called Have Love, Will Travel, which I thought was fitting for this as well, because, you know, traveling and the love, everything in this scene, it fit that. Have Love, Will Travel. So I'm going to put that on there as well, everybody. And now we will head off to the next gig. We'll get in the van and head down the road to the next show. So, Sheila, would you like to tell people where you can be found online and whatnot, where they can get you on TikTok or Instagram?
Oh, of course. Let's have a commercial for a moment. you can find me on the performance name Sheila Wolf. I'm the producer of the Boilers Drag Festival in Berlin. I all of us have my own show. It's called Votable Variety Show. It's a variety about all genders on stage with a lot of burlesque, boilesque, and queerlesque. And of course, you can find me online with on TikTok and with Sheila Wolf, and on Instagram as Sheila Wolf. But I'm more often on TikTok with my new videos. Every day, you can find two videos in a row about my life, about strange thing, about comedy, and of course about transformation. And hey, what else? I mean, yeah, that's all. I mean, I'm leaving Facebook and I'm leaving. And I'm short before to leave Instagram, but TikTok is always on the run.
Well, a lot of people seem to be leaving Facebook, but if you want to speak to me or other listeners, we are on Facebook. We have a group, Hedwig's Wicked Little Town. We're also on Twitter at Hedwig Pod. Instagram, same, Hedwig Pod. And come and check out the Patreon, because you can just give a couple of dollars and you get even more episodes where we review. At the moment, we're going through Rent, the musical.
Nice.
And nice. You also get my other show, Bat Minute, where we review Batman. You get all the bonus episodes of that as well for one price. So you get everything included. It's very cheap, very cheap. It just basically goes, it goes to just paying for equipment.
that's literally it.
I don't make any profit.
We all never make profit anymore because Corona is fuck up. And but we do it because we love it.
Yep, exactly. Because we love it. And we love you, everybody. So do join me again for the next episode of Hedwig Inch by Angry Inch. It'll be chapter 16. Ooh, what can be happening? You'll have to tune in to find out. Bye.
Thank you very much. Bye-bye. Ooh, have a nice time.
There it lies, feigning shock. My personal hair system. My hair. My head rig.
A night like this, when the world's a bit
amiss,
and the lights go down across the trailer park, I get down, I feel head, feel on the verge of going mad, and then it's time to punch the clock.
I put on some makeup, I turn up the tape deck, and pull the wig down on my head. Suddenly I miss Midwest midnight checkout queen until I head home and I put myself to bed. I look back on where I'm from, look at the woman I've become, and the strangest things seem suddenly routine. I look up from my vermouth on the rocks, a gift wrapped wig still in the box of tiring velveteen. I put on some makeup, some lavender baker. I'm pulling the wig down from the shelf. Suddenly I miss Beehive 1963 until I head home
and I turn back to myself. Some girls, they got natural ease. They wear it any way they please, with their French flip curls and their perfumed magazines. Wear it up, let it down. This is the best way that I've found to be the best you've ever seen. I put on some makeup and turn on the 8-track. I'm pulling the wig down from the shelf. Suddenly I'm Miss Farrah Fawcett from TV. Until I wake up and I turn back to myself.
Shack by Little Bob, Darby and will do. Sausage curls, chicken wings, it's all because of you. With your blow-dry tail, the back, Tony home with two. Flip, throw, frizz, flop, it's all because of you. It's all because of you, it's all because of you.
Okay, everybody, you sing, I listen.
I put on some makeup.
Oh yeah, that's it.
I turn on the 8-track and pull the wig down from the shelf.
Careful, that wig's expensive.
Suddenly I'm this punk rock star of stage and screen.
And I ain't ever.
I'm never turning back.
Christian, I wish you could play Hedwig.